Hello to all. We're pleased you're joining us today. We'll get started with the seminar in just a moment. We're pleased that you all could join us. Thank you for joining the Nuclear Threat Initiative for this seminar with Christopher Painter. My name is Erin Dumbacher, a senior program officer in the Science and Technical Affairs Group here at NTI, and I'm your moderator for today. The NTI seminar series is meant to foster new and creative thinking on issues relating to weapons of mass destruction and disruption. And so here is our agenda for today. We hope to discuss the escalation risks of cyber attacks and the potential for cooperation and diplomacy to reduce those risks. And today our key question is really, could international cybersecurity cooperation bring stability just as relations among the United States, China, Russia, and others continue to deteriorate? So whether you're a cybersecurity expert, a nuclear policy specialist, or you're simply concerned about catastrophic risk, we welcome you and your contributions and your comments and questions. A couple of virtual event reminders for you. The first, please note that today's session is on the record and will be recorded. Our team will upload the recording and you all will receive a link to that recording for your reference or further sharing in follow-up emails after the event. Number two, I invite you to submit questions and comments in the Q&A box on your screen. Please do include your name and your affiliation. Thank you also to those of you who submitted thoughtful questions when you registered for the event. We're gonna try to get to as many questions as we can. During the event, you may see links that are for your reference or other information. It'll pop up for you in the chat function, so be on the lookout there. And if you are active on Twitter, please feel free to tag us at NTI_WMD, or you can use the hashtag NTI Seminar. We have approximately an hour together, and I'll be back after opening remarks to moderate the Q&A. And so with that, Secretary Moniz is NTI CEO, and the virtual floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Erin, and thanks to all of you for joining us for today's NTI seminar with Chris Painter, a globally recognized leader and expert on cyber policy. He was the United States' top cyber diplomat in the State Department. Now he's president of the Global Forum on Cyber Expertise Foundation, among many other roles. I mean, he's in great demand, both here in the United States and internationally. He joins us, as Erin indicated, for a discussion of how cooperation can prevent cyber attacks, escalation, and potentially nuclear war. I'll also add that Chris was the first coordinator for cyber issues at the State Department. Before that, he was a senior official at the Department of Justice and the FBI, where he prosecuted high-profile cybercrime cases. He also served on the National Security Council. Now, NTI seminars are designed to hopefully inspire productive dialogue on issues related to reducing threats from weapons of mass destruction and disruption. Chris is a leading expert on international cybersecurity policy and has been instrumental in developing cooperative measures, including with China, to reduce tensions in cyberspace. At NTI, we've been tracking cyber threats to nuclear weapons and nuclear facilities for several years. In today's fraught geopolitical environment, a cyber attack could lead to miscalculation, false warning, or other blunder, ultimately resulting in a catastrophic use of nuclear weapons. Not even the most classified, protected, and secure weapons in the world, nuclear weapons, are immune from cyber attack, for example, through the command and control and early warning systems. So we've invited Chris to share with us his experiences of using diplomacy to reduce risk in the cyber domain and to discuss how we might avoid escalation. We are really very fortunate to be able to hear Chris's thoughts on cybersecurity. And with that, let's turn it over to the main speaker. Chris, floor is yours.
Thanks very much. It's really a pleasure to be here with all of you today on this very important topic and how these different areas, traditionally treated as different areas, have come together. First, I just wanted to talk a little bit about popular culture. For those of the folks that know me, when I was at the State Department, I tried to make my State Department office a little more unique. I mean, usually you have trinkets from all over the world, and of course we had those too. but I had movie posters where hackers or computers were the main characters. Go to the next slide. Okay, this is my favorite. So the first one is a movie called Colossus, the Forbin Project, which I saw when I was in grade school, 1970, first movie where computers took over the world. The US builds this giant supercomputer to control its nuclear arsenal, have perfect deterrence, and take the man out of the middle. The Soviets, stole the information, built their own supercomputer. The two computers talked to each other, became self-aware, and took away all civil liberties and took over the world to protect mankind from itself. So one of the first nuclear cyber movies. And of course, everyone knows, next slide, everyone knows War Games and what happened there, including an intrusion into command and control in a different way, and also false missile warnings, which we'll talk about a little later on. And then finally, and there are many other movies like this, finally, the last slide of this, the movie Black Hat, which is really not a very good movie in many different ways, but in the opening premise, a nuclear power plant is intruded into and the cooling systems are shut down. So peripheral systems are shut down in a way that actually causes the power plant to melt down. And although when I saw the movie, I didn't think that was very practical, realistic, I understand that can happen. So done with the slides for now. So I want to transition to the cyber landscape writ large, the kind of threats we're seeing. And I think what we see is a number of different threat actors in cyberspace, dedicated nation states, sophisticated nation states, transnational organized cyber groups, criminal groups, and what I call lone gunman hackers. We also see the potential of terrorists. They use the internet more to communicate than they do to attack systems, but that can always change. And I want to focus on the nation state actors who are very capable, dedicated, our national threat assessment has talked about the most capable actors being Russia, China, but with Iran and North Korea coming up fast and really full spectrum actors in the way they operate in cyberspace. And what we've seen over the years is both a combination of a theft and intrusions so for espionage and other purposes, and disruptive and destructive activity. Back in 2007, Estonia, which was highly dependent, still is highly dependent on cyber systems, was the subject of an attack, what was called a denial of service attack. When Russia had the military action involving Georgia, cyber was a key part of that. More recently, we had something called the NotPetya worm, very destructive computer worm that took down systems all over the world, including the Maersk shipping giant, which had a major effect on international commerce that was attributed to Russia. Iran launched what was called the WannaCry, North Korea launched what was called the WannaCry worm, which among other things took down the UK's national health system. We have had Russian attacks on the Ukrainian power grid, shutting it down for a short time. More recently, we've had criminal groups going after the Colonial Pipeline system, which caused long lines for gas in the US. And even though they didn't attack the central system controlling fuel, they attacked systems that dealt with billing and other purposes, and that had an effect on the infrastructure itself. And of course, we've seen the reports just this week and last week about attacks on Ukrainian government systems, likely by Russia, not complete attribution, but likely by Russia, including destructive code placed in those systems that could be part of preparing the battlefield for war and certainly could have more destructive consequences going forward. We've also had a number of warnings that were issued by our Department of Homeland Security and FBI recently about potential Russian attacks on US infrastructure, particularly in connection with the Ukrainian, any Ukrainian military action Russia may go into. We've had disinformation campaigns that affected our election by Russia. And we've had some, but not very many, of something that I really fear in the way the most, which are integrity attacks. So we've had these attacks that are penetrating systems to steal information. We have them disrupt information. But if you have an attack that changes the information, that could be really debilitating. So my friend, the former president of Estonia, Thomas Ilves, always said, look, I care if there is an attack that knocks my website offline so I can't get to it. I care a lot more if someone gets into the hospital and changes my blood type and I die the next time I get a transfusion. So those kinds of integrity attacks, I think we really need to worry about. And what this all illustrates is that we are increasingly dependent on cyber for everything, not just in the military sector, which the US military really depends on cyber for weapon systems, for command and control, for communications, but for really all of our infrastructure, almost all of our infrastructure, the electrical power grid, financial networks, others depend on cyber technologies, which means we're vulnerable because any system that is connected, and even systems that are not connected, and any system that is dependent on computer technology can never be made 100% safe. There are too many different dependencies. There's too much complexity. We can do a lot to up our game and to be more secure, but they can never be made 100% safe. And a dedicated adversary, and especially these countries I mentioned, are dedicated to trying to intrude into our systems, get footholds into our systems, get access to our systems. And indeed, many other countries, including the US, are doing the same thing. The US and many other countries are developing what we call offensive cyber capabilities to be able to project cyber power internationally to get into other countries' systems for both defensive and offensive purposes. And that, I think, creates a more unstable environment across the world, depending on how this is used and where it's used and what systems are targeted. So what does all this have to do with nuclear, with either nuclear weapons, nuclear power plants, and potentially nuclear war? And I want to talk about three areas here. I mean, one is, a lot of people in the cyber world and the kind of academic world and the deterrence world have tried to draw parallels between cyber and nuclear. And they're very different. Those parallels don't really work. A number of folks, including Joe Nye, have said that those don't really work very, very well. So for instance, cyber is different in terms of it being an asymmetric threat. Unlike nuclear, you don't need a huge investment of resources to have cyber capability as a country or even as a third party criminal group. There is no aspect of mutually assured destruction with cyber as there is in nuclear. Since cyber is, and we've seen it used by nation states at very low thresholds and even to project power when they can't militarily. When, for instance, Iran launched what we call distributed denial of service attacks on US financial systems over a protracted period, in dissatisfaction with US policy toward Iran, they were able to do that. And also they were able to try to hide their identity because unlike the nuclear world where you know where things are, you see launch plumes, you can figure out, you can count missiles. You really can't do that with cyber. There are no launch plumes. There is this sense of a potential anonymity that especially dedicated actors can use proxies and others to try to hide their identity. Now, I think we can do attribution much better than is often supposed in cyberspace. I think we have been able to do attribution often and we have with other countries to call out countries like Russia and North Korea and Iran and China. I think we're going to continue to do that in the future. So attribution is not as impossible, but it is more complex than it does in the nuclear world. And the other thing about cyber capabilities are their dual use technologies. It's hard to really define what a cyber weapon is. So when you talk about, for instance, arms control in cyberspace, what is a cyber weapon? They can be used for defensive purposes. They could be used for the same code can be used for defensive purposes to help bolster a network security. And it can be used for offensive purposes. So what is the intent of the actor when you see these tools? Can you really have a regime that has any control over cyber tools when they are fast changing technologically and it's not clear what their character is in the first place? I think that also goes to whether arms control works in cyberspace at all. And I think you can look at the effects of cyber tools, and we'll talk about that later in this discussion, but it's really hard to, again, kind of control what a cyber tool is. So there's parallels, for deterrence and kind of conceptual thought don't really work very well with cyber tying it to nuclear, with one exception. And I think that is in the area of confidence and confidence building and transparency measures. And there, just in the nuclear world, measures that allow us to dial down escalation, to avoid escalation, to have better understanding of what's going on, transparency measures, cooperative measures, those I think do apply. And in fact, we, the US, has been at the forefront of championing confidence building measures as part of a larger stability framework that I'll discuss later on, that will be part of this, especially in light of all these countries developing cyber offensive capabilities and using those capabilities in certain circumstances. So this idea of CBM, so that when you see a cyber activity, you don't misperceive it and have escalation, is really important. And I'd say, you know, unlike a lot of other areas in military activity, cyber is still relatively new and misunderstood. The escalation path for cyber, how that works, is not really understood. Countries can have completely different perceptions of what activity is. So in other words, we may think we're sending one message using a cyber tool, where the adversary might take a completely different meaning over that. And so having those areas, those abilities to de-escalate and communicate, are critically important. I'll talk about this as part of some of the measures we've taken, but you know, this is illustrated by the US and Russia reaching an agreement a number of years ago when Obama was in office to create a certain confidence building measures, sharing doctrine, for instance, creating a hotline, an actual hotline that uses the same hotline for nuclear, the Nuclear Risk Reduction Center, that's in the State Department and the military Department of Defense. So you have that aspect, and I think but they're limited analogs. Then you have nuclear as a potential reaction to cyber attacks, and I've talked about all the parade of horribles of potential cyber attacks are out there. And you know, most people say, well, why would you ever respond to a cyber attack with a nuclear strike? And it does seem kind of counterintuitive, especially because, fortunately, the kinds of cyber activities we've seen so far have not caused death. They've caused destruction. They've been serious, but they haven't been these giant incidents. And you certainly can imagine if a cyber incident, just like any incident, had the same effect as a kinetic attack, if it killed large parts of the population, it had major destructive effects, then everything is on the table to respond to it. So it's not completely out of the question to think about that. But it was worrisome back in 2018 when the Trump administration did its nuclear posture review, that is specifically called out that nuclear weapons may be used in response to non-nuclear attacks, including a potential cyber attack and a cyber attack on nuclear command and control systems. Now there is a new nuclear posture review that's going on now. We'll see if that gets dialed back. It could be very potentially escalatory to have that as doctrine. Again, not surprising given the cyber attack can have major consequences, but still problematic. And the third thing that I really want to focus on is the vulnerability of nuclear weapons and systems to cyber events, cyber attacks. At first level, you'd say, well, that can't be true. Cyber weapons cannot be vulnerable to cyber attacks because they have to be air-gapped, as we say in the trade. They have to be completely separate systems that you can access. Certainly the football that the president has is not accessible on the internet, for instance. But you have to look at this in a broader sense. When we talk about nuclear weapons and nuclear systems, or even nuclear power plants or nuclear storage, they are part of a larger ecosystem that includes various components that are subject to various both direct kind of attacks, cyber attacks, but also supply chain attacks, where things come in through the updating process or the modernization process. And you think about the ecosystem for cyber weapons, there is really the ecosystem of the control systems, nuclear command and control more generally, early warning systems, including radar and satellite. And they're all undergirded by complex communication systems that are often intertwined with non-nuclear military capabilities, and including links between the US political leadership and military leadership, links between the US political leadership in other countries, including potentially to dial down escalation. Everything is connected, and everything that's connected, as I said earlier, is vulnerable to a cyber attack, especially if it's connected, but even in times we've seen cyber intrusions where the systems were not connected because of insiders or others. So, you know, that the nuclear posture review that I noted did call out that the NC3 system, nuclear command and control, were vulnerable. And we've seen a number of things in the past. In 2013, there was a Defense Science Board study that found that DoD computer networks were incredibly vulnerable to various cyber attacks. There's been DoD red team, or what they call pen testers, who've gone in to test DoD systems between 2012 and 2017, that found a range of vulnerabilities and were able to take over systems with quite a lot of ease, really surprising amount of ease. And NTI, and I really call out to NTI here, has done a number of studies on nuclear storage facilities and noted they could be subject to cyber attacks that would disable the physical security and allow fissile material to be stolen. And in 2017, there were intrusions into US nuclear power sites by malware. There was discovered malware, Russian computer malware, that was on their business systems, not on their actual command and control systems of those nuclear power plants. But you know, that could be a prelude to moving over those systems. And it was a real issue of whether or not that was there for espionage to find out information, this malicious cyber code, or if it was there as prepositioning to a later attack. And certainly if it's there for prepositioning, or even if you have the confusion of whether it's there or not for that purpose, that could be very destabilizing as well. And then in 2020, we had the SolarWinds, what's called supply chain attack, that among other things, hit the nuclear agency at the Department of Energy. Now, again, didn't go into command and control, but that still is significant. I mentioned the 2016 study. NTI also did a 2018 study where it looked at nuclear weapons in the cyber age and posited a number of sobering and really scary scenarios, including cyber compromise of weapon systems and communications channels. This could be through supply chain. This could be through other kinds of attacks. It would make those systems unreliable, or at least present the challenge that they could be unreliable. And first, that undermines cyber deterrence. Second, that could, because of the short decision cycle for whether to launch or not launch cyber weapons, it could cause either US or another country to launch prematurely because they don't really rely, or they can't rely on their systems. There's another scenario where the cyber early warning system spoofs an inbound missile attack. That actually was one of the things that happened in War Games, but there was a non-cyber event that happened in 1980 that was like this, and that goes to that integrity issue. Can you rely on the information you see? Malicious code discovered in the national or the nuclear command and control system. Again, you'd be struggling with, is that something that was there for espionage or for destabilization? Could that cause escalation? And then a larger issue that we've dealt with for some time, which is cascading cyber attacks on critical infrastructure, including the electrical power grid and others of which defense systems rely, but also that starts creating real damage. And does that spin up into a possible more military escalation or even a nuclear escalation? So all those issues are significantly scary. So what do we do about it? I mean, if those vulnerabilities there, if this possibility is there, and there's a number of things we can do. We can harden the targets, obviously. We can do better to protect our systems, and that's something where there's a lot of efforts underway on that. We can do efforts to disaggregate systems that are connected to the internet or systems that are nuclear command and control and for more conventional forces. That's challenging for a number of reasons, but if you want to avoid the fog of war when there are attacks on non-cyber systems, but they're linked to cyber or to nuclear systems, that might be something you do. But some steps that I think would be important are, how do you cooperate against these threats? How do you have better transparency and cooperation? On the one hand, every country can cooperate in terms of its, hardening the targets and having better cybersecurity. So Obama, at the Nuclear Security Summit in 2016, called on all governments that were there, the 30 governments, to have better cybersecurity around these systems. And that needs to be an ongoing international effort. There is an effort in the US writ large on these issues to have a cyber stability framework. So me and Michelle Markoff, my deputy at state and acting coordinator now there, really led this effort to have international law applies to cyberspace, just like in the physical world. CBMs were important. And the third leg is certain norms of behavior, acceptable behavior by nation states. in cyberspace. And one of those norms is don't attack the critical infrastructure of another country absent wartime, that when you're in peacetime. Now, the issue with that, however, is that these norms are voluntary. We haven't been very good at actually enforcing those norms. There hasn't been accountability or consequences for people who breach those norms, and that's been a problem. So accountability has made those norms less strong because people think they can violate them with impunity. And the critical infrastructure norm, there's, you know, I think a real question, would that apply to military systems? Because critical infrastructure is covered that provides services to the public, and military systems are often seen as fair game between states subject to certain constraints. And so do we need something more? And I would say that there are a number of things that we can think about doing. I think we've had great progress in terms of laying out that foundation of international stability more generally for cyberspace, which helps that kind of general escalation. I think confidence building is important. But we can think about, can we focus on some of the nuclear issues? Can we have dialogues with Russia, for instance, on having a norm, for instance, that neither side should go after the other's command and control system for nuclear because it's so potentially escalatory and so potentially damaging? You know, I think we've all decided we can't really have a cyber weapons treaty. That's been argued by some. It doesn't really make sense for some of the reasons I talked about before, but maybe we can have a bilateral agreement, maybe then ripening into a multilateral agreement that neither side should go after the command and control system or implant code there that could be misperceived. There are problems with that. You know, how do you determine what is a nuclear control system, what's not, when they're integrated with military control systems? That goes to the aggregation problem I mentioned earlier. How do you verify compliance? How do you determine whether it's espionage or a destructive thing? If it's just there, you know, it could be for espionage. So do you ban any kind of intrusion at all? So, and you know, the current atmosphere with Russia is also very difficult, just geopolitically, in terms of reaching agreement on issues. We've had some progress on ransomware recently, and that's good, but of course there are tensions with respect to Ukraine and many other things. So how are we gonna be able to reach this? So, you know, I think that a major step forward is gonna be both those bilateral dialogues, but also larger, continuing the larger international dialogues with this, also integrating cyber as a concern in all sort of nuclear discussions and vice versa. So we have these communities brought closer together, which I think is important. So all of that leads to the last slide I have. So if you put up the last slide. Okay, so I started, and this is my background too. I started with the movie Colossus, which I said was one of my favorites. And this is the actual Colossus. It's the first digital electronic programmable computer in the world. It is at Bletchley Park in the UK. And it was used to break the Nazi Lorenz code, the high level code that was used by the Nazi high command. So unlike the movie Colossus, which is very dystopian, the actual Colossus helped save the world. And I think that we can use these technologies. We're gonna be using these technologies going in the future. We can have more cooperative measures, more diplomatic measures to try to dial down the risk. We may not be able to ever eliminate the risk, but dial down the risk and make sure that we're taking action as a community and we're acting together. And sometimes that's like-minded countries acting together. Sometimes it's gonna be the US acting unilaterally or bilaterally with another country, but it's critical we do it now. The vulnerabilities are too great, the risks are too great. Even if we didn't take nuclear into account, they're too great, but nuclear certainly ups the ante significantly. So cooperation, I think, is going to be critically important. It's not the whole answer, but it's a critical part of it. And with that, I think I've run out of time, so I'll stop.
Well, thank you, Chris. And by the way, my first question was going to be, what's the vintage of that background you have there? Presumably with a higher degree of cyber safety than we have today. But,
the Brits actually never commercialized it. They didn't make it public until the mid-70s. So so it was used, they had good OPSEC, but it did actually help save the world.
In my my office, I do have a print from Bletchley Park. So anyway. The question I'm going to have is, I want to go back and pull the thread a little bit on what we said in introducing you about your work with China. Obviously, you know, many talk about the collision course of the United States and China, but yet you appear to have made some progress in a difficult space. Could you say a bit more about the Obama-Xi agreement and sure. How it came about and what it is, and in particular, is it a model for future cooperation?
So, yes, I think that it's a good model for certain reasons. I mean, one of the reasons we were able to reach that agreement was that this is what the U.S. Was complaining, rightly so, about wholesale theft of intellectual property and trade secrets from the commercial sector, but also from government, but from the commercial sector that was then used by China or would be used by China to benefit its own commercial sector. So this is not just normal espionage. This is not normal intelligence gathering. This is something we don't do. We don't think any country should do. And that really fell on deaf ears with China. You know, I led our U.S.-China working group. That didn't really, you know, go anywhere. We indicted some People's Liberation Army officers for that. That didn't really get the Chinese to stop. So this is a big issue. And what I think was key here is that Obama made this not just a cyber issue, but part of the overall relationship between the U.S. and China. So this is not that we're willing to take friction in the overall U.S.-China relationship because this is such a big issue. It's an economic issue. It's a national security issue. It's a future issue. We need to deal with this. And that got China, that among other things, including, I think, the threat of sanctions and the fact that it was just before a summit where I think the Chinese and President Xi wanted to have, you know, a good summit that wasn't really marred by this, got the Chinese to come in and come to the table and agree that no country should do this. We then got a multilateral agreement in the G20 on that, which I think is also a good model. So when there is common interest between countries, even if countries are adversaries and disagree on a wide variety of things, I think the Chinese found that there was common interest because they were getting pressure, not just from the US, but a number of other countries. And, you know, it was sort of hurting their view on the world stage and was hurting them in terms of other issues the US and China had. So I do think it's a model to be used with limitations. So, you know, we have less leverage, I think, with Russia than we do with China, but we do have leverage. And if we think about this not just as a cyber issue, or not just even as a nuclear issue, but a broader all of nation issue, and work with our allies and partners, I think there is beneficial. Now, what I'll say is that agreement was effective for about 2 years, and then the Chinese started doing this more, and there was a significant diminution in their activity. And that was because there wasn't really an incentive for them to do it. The U.S.-China relationships had dissolved to such a point or devolved to such a point that they didn't see an interest in doing it. So you have to figure out how to continue those efforts and how it makes it in both parties' interest to comply.
So compliance basically is no longer respected.
Yeah, I mean, well, right. I mean, you know, we still have everything in our arsenal. We all the tools we have, we can use sanctions, we can use diplomatic actions, law enforcement actions, other actions to try to get the compliance to happen. But, you know, I think that if the Chinese decide it's in their interest to do it, if there are not sufficient consequences for them not to do it, then they'll do it. And I think that's what we're seeing. That's the accountability piece I mentioned with Russia too. You know, we haven't been good at imposing consequences on Russia. So it has the effect of saying, well, why don't I do it again? If it's benefiting me, I'll do it again. And other countries who are on the sidelines can jump in and say, well, you know, they got away with it. They didn't get really hurt very bad. Maybe I'll do it too. So that consequence accountability part, I think, is critical as we go forward, building off the rules of the road that I talked about before.
Mm-hmm. Okay, interesting. I have a lot more questions, but let me turn it to Senator Nunn and see if he has a question, and then we'll go back to Aaron to manage the Q&A more broadly. Sam? Sam was on. Well, okay, Aaron, why don't we just pick up the Q&A then? Maybe Sam fell off.
Sounds good. We have lots of questions. But Chris, I want to start with something that started to come up to connect what you've said related to the current crisis in Central and Eastern Europe. You know, we saw the Russian government recently imprisoned members of the Revil group, who was reportedly responsible for the Colonial Pipeline attack in the US. Do you agree that this was a signal to the United States and its allies that the Russians might allow for cyber attacks against American critical infrastructure to proceed, perhaps, should certain other actions from the West be taken, like economic sanctions, for example? You know, could we see really devastating attacks in Ukraine as well as in NATO members, even though we have some of these international agreements that you've described in hand?
Yeah, I think we could see them. I think that's why we saw DHS and FBI warning of potential attacks, not just obviously in Ukraine, but attacks in the US and allied systems too, as Russia might try to project power or cause disruption or warn against more action against Russia because they'll do things to us. I remember after the election interference in 2016, our then DNI, Jim Clapper, said that one of the reasons we didn't take stronger action is we were worried about actions Russia might take because we're so dependent on these technologies, which is not a particularly good place to be. So, you know, even though we have these kind of voluntary agreements, these norms, they unfortunately are violated because we haven't had those consequences in the past. And the same tool set we use to try to dissuade cyber activity is the same tool set we're trying to use to dissuade other malicious activity by Russia or other countries. So, for instance, we were able to get cooperation, surprising cooperation by Russia against these criminal groups. Usually Russia, and I used to chair our G8 group and among others, usually Russia is not very fond of cooperating as long as the criminal activity is not targeting Russia. They're happy to have disruption, destruction, you know, chaos in the West, but they're going after them, they only don't do much of anything. Sometimes they're proxies, sometimes they're independent groups, sometimes there's corruption involved. So the fact they took action was significant. What the follow-up of that action would be, who knows yet. Was that linked to the Ukraine action? Potentially, it could be a message saying, hey, we'll cooperate, we'll do more of this kind of thing, but if you sanction us, all bets are off and we're gonna let these people go. That's entirely possible. But I also think the US will disaggregate that. I mean, that we're able to walk and chew gum at the same time and look at our interests in the Ukraine and Europe and our interests in terms of the ransomware actors and try to make it as part of a larger whole. But I do think there are challenges there. And I don't think that Russia would be afraid to use cyber as a tool. Both, you know, clearly they're going to use it as part of an invasion if they do invade. That's going to happen to destabilize command and control, et cetera, in the Ukraine. But also I would not be surprised if they're trying to send a warning to us of don't get involved. Don't do anything to us because we'll just come back more strongly against you. And as I said, it's the same tool set. So a number of people argued for years that our sanctions have not been targeted in ways that would change Putin's actions, things like his own money flows, his cronies, et cetera. The problem is you have a limited space. So if you threaten that for cyber activities, what's left to threaten for physical activities like invasion of the Ukraine? And I think that illustrates one of the problems in the space. We only have so many tools at our disposal. We need to figure out how we enhance our tools and have others and work with partners to enforce it.
And of course, historically, Ukraine has been a little bit of a test bed for Russian activity in the past, sometimes aligned with prior and sort of ongoing invasions, right? So anything in the future.
Well, we saw that in Georgia too, but also, you know, also a test bed for capability, like the intrusions and shutdown of the Ukrainian power plants back a couple of years ago.
So keeping with the U.S.-Russia relationship for a moment, we have a couple of questions about the U.S. and Russia holding each other at risk within their nuclear command and control system. So do you believe at this point that sort of the U.S. and Russia have, this is a question from Tom Kalina, have placed implants in nuclear command and control systems? And then how does that relate to, if true, sort of confidence in nuclear launchability, and then connecting to Leonard Spector's questions, you know, could that reduce reliability of nuclear forces?
Yeah, so I don't know. We do know that Russia and other services are intent and intruding into US systems. Obviously, nuclear command and control would be a target that they want to go after and get a foothold in. What you don't know, and this is a really dangerous thing, is, you know, as the questions said, and actually as your NTI report also said, that if those systems are seen to be unreliable because there are intrusions into them, whether they be direct intrusions, supply chain intrusions, or others, that does have a real effect on the deterrence. You know, if you don't, the whole idea of deterrence in nuclear is that you have the capability to cause the other side harm so they won't launch a nuclear attack in the first place. If that's not true, all bets are off, you know, and that's a real problem. If you have you know, uncertainty in how you use nuclear weapons when the decision cycle is so small or somehow you create confusion, that's a huge deal too. But the flip side of that is it's hugely escalatory. If I find malicious code in my nuclear command and control system and I'm able to attribute that to, say, you know, Russia, that's a huge deal. Now, when we saw that malicious code in nuclear power plants, but again, not in their control systems, there was a big hue and cry about that, certainly, because you don't know Is that there just to gather intelligence? Is that there to figure out what our intent is, which might be a peaceful thing? Or is that there to actually disrupt either prepositioning for an actual conflict of some kind, or to hold us at risk, or to take away our deterrence? And that's why I think, you know, discussion about not targeting those systems is, though very difficult and hard to, as I mentioned, to get agreement on or even compliance on, is worth pursuing, because that could be so dangerous on either side, because you don't know how to read that. We may assume something, or they may assume something that's not really our or their intent, and that would be disastrous, or could be disastrous.
I see Senator Nunn is back with us. Senator, the floor is yours for a question.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, Chris, thank you for your great work in this. Thank you for your presentation. And you're one of our most valuable resources, obviously, in a world that is searching for answers. And I think searching for mutual interest in this area. Speaking of which, David Sanger has reported a number of times, including most recently in the last 2 days in public publications, that we have penetrated the Russians' infrastructure. They have penetrated our infrastructure. Do you think in the cyber world there's any such thing as mutual assured infrastructure destruction when we're not quite sure whether it's mutual and we're not sure whether it's assured? And it may be disruption, but it may be destruction. I mean, how do we approach that? Is this a mutual interest that we really ought to make a top priority? And the second question I have is fail-safe review, and that something Ernie and I have been pushing, NTI has been pushing, asking the Pentagon interagency review of all of our nuclear systems, particularly with the danger of blunder, and particularly not exclusively cyber.
Yeah.
So my second question is, what would be your priorities if we're able to get that fail-safe review done or undertaken by the Biden administration?
Yeah, first on the fail-safe review. I mean, look, I think that's critical. I think just in preparing for this talk, the potential exposure, especially to the larger nuclear command and control infrastructure that's there, is huge. And we do have dedicated nation states and others trying to get into it, and they're not, they're very sophisticated, and that's a problem. And if we don't constantly focus on that, that could be a huge vulnerability for us for all the reasons we talked about in the last half hour. So I do think that, you know, cyber certainly is not the only priority in doing such a review, but I think it has to be one of the things that's considered, looking at not just the nuclear command and control systems themselves, but the dependent systems and communication channels that they're based on. Are there other interdependencies with? So I do think that's critically important. I don't think you can do things like that enough. You need to constantly update, especially with cyber. The technology and the attack vectors change so quickly that you have to really constantly keep your eye on the ball and do this. You can't just do a one-off and wait another 10 years and figure out, okay, we're safe, because that's just not true. So I commend that effort. I think that absolutely should be done. On the issue of mutually assured sort of infrastructure destruction, I mean, this is one of the reasons the US has spearheaded this stability framework idea and these ideas of norms of behavior below the threshold of an armed attack, or even above the threshold. Now, we haven't seen actual destructive activity of that level yet. And that's because of a lot of things, interdependencies, entanglement. We haven't actually been at war with China or Russia, at least in a traditional war. So that all may change. Is there prepositioning on infrastructure? Well, I mean, one thing that's true about cyber is, despite the kind of movie view of cyber, you just can't push a button and launch a cyber attack. You have to have access to the systems you're trying to affect. And that could take a while, even for a sophisticated country or service, to get access to those systems, get a penetration of those systems, where they then can launch something. And as I said, that could be dual use. That could be used for intelligence gathering purposes or to launch a disabling attack. So is there prepositioning happening now? I would not be surprised. It'd be surprising if there wasn't attempts to do that for that very purpose, so that you don't have to then gain access in a short, like if we had something happen in South China Sea tomorrow and the president asked for cyber responses, you know, they'd have to be planned in advance. Same thing for our adversaries. So And that can be very dangerous. So one of the things, the stability framework I talked about, although it doesn't talk about necessarily implanting, that's still sort of a gray area, that if you trigger any of those things, that there are certain things that should be off limits, that the international community should agree are off limits. And those are things like electrical power plants, financial sectors, the critical things that the critical infrastructure we depend on. And we're focused there on targets, whether targets should be on or off the table, and got an agreement among all the countries in the UN to those norms. Now, again, they're voluntary norms, but there's still political commitments by these countries. And I think if we see those, if we see that kind of prepositioning, it's something we should speak out about and raise both bilaterally with the other country, but also raise in the international community. So yeah, I am worried about that. I don't think you never know what you don't know. You never know what you haven't seen. Given all the activity we've seen, the clever activity from the Russians in using cyber means, including what we call supply chain attacks, that Solar Winds attack used a piece of software that was used to, as a back office thing. So no one paid attention to it, but it had major effects on US government agencies and also industry. I would not be surprised at all if there wasn't a lot of prepositioning that's out there, and it's something we should be concerned about.
The media has reported pretty extensively on US and potential Israeli use of exploiting digital vulnerabilities to slow the Iranian nuclear program in the operation that's now sort of been known as Stuxnet. And I'm impressed we are just now getting to Stuxnet in this conversation. Usually it's the first thing mentioned. But given that, some have talked about how that ushered in a new era, if you will, of cyber conflict, questioning, whether or not that was the right choice to make to move forward with that operation. And Matthew Bunn asks, didn't Stuxnet include an integrity attack that made it look like the centrifuges were functioning normally? So I guess one sort of point of order question there, but then the broader question is, was ushering this new era of conflict, if that's indeed what it was, the right action?
I mean, first on whether it's an integrity attack reportedly, at least that's what's reported, that that was part of it to disguise the operation. You had unreliable centrifuges, but you thought you had a reliable one. So that's at least reportedly what's out there. And it's a hard question because, as I said, all these countries are developing military capabilities. And even if the US hadn't developed military capabilities more generally, like cyber command, other countries would do this anyway. It's a new spectrum, unfortunately, of warfare and capabilities. So they're going to do that. I can't comment on who was responsible for that operation or how it worked, but I'd say that you can actually make an interesting argument about that. Was it smarter to use cyber tools in that and other instances rather than using kinetic tools? So for instance, if you were trying to interdict what you saw as a threatening development, nuclear weapon development, another way to do it is they could have dropped bombs on the centrifuge networks, and that would have killed people, it would have had second and third order effects. Was using a more targeted cyber tool in that instance something that actually was a better course than using kinetic tools? And that's an interesting question. Maybe cyber tools targeted, if you use in a targeted way, are a better way to go. Does that create the sort of cyber arms race? I think that probably would have happened anyway. So it's really hard to judge whether that was right. Reports again are that did slow the development of their system significantly. So there were tangible gains supposedly that came out of that. And I think you have to weigh all those things together. But I don't think if that had never happened, we would be in a place where no one's using cyber for military means. It's just, I think that's a flight of fancy.
Liz Kim from the Voice of America has asked, how seriously do you see the connection of North Korea's cyber activities to its pursuit of nuclear weapons?
So I think North Korea has often used cyber as for two reasons. One, to get money for the regime. They have a lot of hackers who are engaged in financial and what we normally would think is criminal activity, like going after, for instance, the Bank of Bangladesh, where they did a major heist there. Mostly nation states are not after money. They're after other geopolitical gains, but North Korea is after money. And the other is to, we've also seen them kind of protest things they didn't like going after Sony Pictures for the very bad movie that was made about their leader, their dear leader. So So, you know, that was, you know, more of a geopolitical thing. And then, you know, they use it, you know, to project power beyond what they normally could. Now, is that linked to their nuclear program? I don't think so. I mean, it certainly could be. They might be trying to get these same purchases in our systems as others. As I said, they're not as sophisticated as Russia and China, so unclear, you know, what access and abilities they have. One question came up back a few years ago when we started the nuclear talks that Trump tried to launch with North Korea, of whether cyber should be part of those talks. And I said, well, you know, personally, I care about cyber deeply, but I care about nuclear even more. So yes, cyber should be part of those talks down the line, but it shouldn't be conditioned to having those talks in the first place, you know. So I do think you can disaggregate those, but certainly North Korea continues to be a malicious cyber actor, more to, I think, project power beyond what they can, because they don't have the military, the conventional military capability to cause us any real harm. Nuclear is a different issue, obviously.
There's also been some reporting that North Korean hackers, perhaps sometimes existing outside of the country, have also taken up actions that are revenue generating potentially for the nuclear program.
The North Korean diaspora. I mean, that's right. They raise money. They raise hard currency for the state, so that state can use it for a whole host of purposes, including to advance their nuclear program.
Aaron Kaka asks, are you aware of any plans to install a diplomatic red phone similar to the hotline between the United States and Russia with China? Presumably, I think the question is about the US to China. Yeah. I believe there's a military one, but if that's used, is that a sign that things have escalated too far?
Well, you know, it's interesting because we were able to reach this agreement with Russia to use the traditional hotline, which, as you know, is not a phone. It is a text system where you pre-program messages, a nuclear risk reduction center. And that was a big deal. Now, has it been used that effectively by either side? Not so much. We did try to use it during the election interference, but the Russians answer was like, show us all the evidence. And that really wasn't something that fostered further communication. But the whole idea behind that was if we saw a major event, and you can imagine, like, if we saw a malicious code in our nuclear command and control system, this would be one of the reasons we'd say, hey, you know, what is this? So that makes sense. But we had a long history of dealing with confidence building measures and other kinds of measures with Russia during the nuclear age. We don't have that long history with China. So when me and Michelle and others raised this with our Chinese counterparts in our conversations with them, they, for a long time, were really resistant to it. I think they saw even having a hotline or exchange of information as a way to get information on them, and they weren't getting anything out of it because they didn't have that history. And I remember in a track 2 dialogue with China, we talked to them about hotlines, and they said, oh, we have lots of hotlines with the US. We have like 28 of them, but no one ever seems to answer them. So that 28 hotlines is as bad as having one hotline. And then back when we had the deal on cyber espionage or commercial espionage, we talked about a hotline, and they wanted to do a sort of essentially a law enforcement hotline. But the issues we're talking about here are not law enforcement issues. They are, you know, more strategic issues. So I do think there's more willingness on the Chinese side to think about that now, to have something. The question is, where do you put it in China? You know, what level, who has the con? You can't really put it in the Ministry of Public Security. That's more criminal. So where do you put it where it actually can be effective? I think there's a possibility of doing that now where there really wasn't before. I think it's something that would be a good thing to try to pursue.
Well, we're talking a little bit about sort of State Department infrastructure for this. Do we in the US government need to better organize ourselves for managing cyber diplomacy? Secretary of State Blinken, of course, recently announced a new Bureau of Cyberspace and Digital Policy. But, you know, what do you think the first leader there should bring? What unique role should that bureau then have sort of within the US government?
Yeah, so, the U.S. really led the way in this, in creating my old office back in 2011. I mean, that was the first office like that in the world that reported at a high level to the Secretary of State. There are now 40 of them, and, you know, both in our friends and our frenemies around the world have offices like this, and a number of countries have more of that. And I think that's been important because it treats cyber more as a diplomatic and policy issue and not just a technical issue. It's fostered a lot of both communication among like-minded countries. I mean, one one thing that we sort of spearheaded in terms of this consequence and accountability part was really based on the non-proliferation initiative, getting like-minded countries to work together to interdict various cyber threats. And that is being carried out now by the State Department as part of a deterrence initiative. So it is critical to have that State Department voice in this, that larger diplomatic voice. And first, a real call out to my colleagues who were still there, I mean, who operated through the Trump years when things were sort of deprioritized in a lot of areas, and who have been doing lots of great work in this area and continue to do great work in this area. And I think that's really important. The new office, I think, is exactly the right step. It needs to be cross-cutting. It needs to be at a high level. It's reporting to the Deputy Secretary, to Wendy Sherman, who was involved in these issues even when I was there, when she was political undersecretary. So you need whoever you have in that job and the whole supporting infrastructure. First, it has an interagency role to play. It has a role to talk about these diplomatic and other issues and these tools and the interagency approach to both cyber attacks and physical and other geopolitical attacks. And that, DOD is important, obviously DHS, DOJ, the economic agents, but the US, the diplomatic part is a key part. So that's one. And then two is really to project internationally, to work with our partners and friends internationally. It's not like we haven't been doing that, but having that high level position back and having someone who has that gravitas because they have the authority from the Secretary and Deputy Secretary of State and a real symbol to the rest of the world that we take these issues seriously and it's important, I think is critically important. So I was really happy with the announcement they made. I thought it was exactly the right structure. I hope they find someone to fill that position relatively soon because state is such a critical player that you need that leadership there. And again, not taking anything away from the great people who are there now who are doing a great job.
I think I have time for one more question, and I'm going to combine several. So looking a little bit ahead, could you prioritize in the broader context of cyber and potential escalation to nuclear? Could you prioritize, what is the piece that sort of keeps you up at night? Is it AI and its intersection with that? Is it something else, some other sort of gap in the escalation risks that we already live with when it comes to nuclear weapons?
I mean, AI right now is more of a buzzword than anything else. Yes, AI is important. Yes, AI is going to be the future. Yes, I'm worried about kind of automated attacks and systems where they don't have a person in the middle. So I worry about all that. But I do worry about this thing I mentioned, these integrity attacks. I do worry, which we haven't seen as much of, but if we see more of those where we can't rely on the information we have, that has profound consequences for nuclear command and control, has profound consequences for our financial markets, for our critical infrastructure, for just trust in the internet and computer networks more generally. And I do really worry about seeing more of that in the future and seeing these blendings of criminal groups and nation states. I don't think, the good message over the last 30 years I've been looking at this issue is that we're paying a lot more attention to it. We finally made it a national security priority. I think ransomware helped drive that. When people had to line up for gas, it helped drive people saying we need to treat this as a no kidding priority. And the US has done a lot in terms of its structure here at the White House, et cetera, to really focus on this issue. And other countries have too. So that's the good thing. On the bad side, the threats have become greater, more sophisticated, more actors are jumping into this. We're more dependent on these technologies than ever. We haven't done a great job of hardening the targets that we need to do. We haven't done a great job of imposing consequences on bad actors. So there's a lot more to do. So I do worry about all of that because, we're not going to go backwards. This is just going to continue. We're going to become more digital in the future, and we need to secure that in the best way possible if we're going to, have a peaceful existence.
Thank you, Chris. I'm going to echo a comment that just came in saying that you get it in a way that's rare. So thank you so much for your work on this and for your comments today. And Secretary Moniz, the floor is back to you.
Okay, well, thanks, Aaron and Chris. But I'm going to violate the rules and sneak in one last question because we have a question that came in from a Pakistani student of international relations. And just to skip ahead, have you given any thought to how cyber might be an escalatory component in the India-Pakistan relationship, including the nuclear relationship?
Yeah, it's interesting. I participated in a you know, track two a number of years ago involving India on nuclear and cyber. And so, and you know, as you guys are much more aware than I, you know, India's nuclear posture is a lot different than the US, and when they might use nuclear weapons. I think it's if there's any territorial attack on India's territorial integrity, which, you know, given the situation, that's very worrisome, right? That could be a very low bar. And we have seen lots of cyber attacks between India and Pakistan over the last number of years. So that certainly is there. So could that be a triggering event? Again, I hope not. However, it's the same things I said apply in the US. If you had a major cyber attack that caused death and destruction, potentially, just like an actual incursion, territorial incursion would. Could you lose control or lose confidence in your own nuclear systems that could escalate things? Potentially. I don't know what the protections are like on either Pakistan's or India's nuclear systems, or whether they're really focusing on some of these cyber activities with respect to those systems. They are taking cybersecurity more seriously. So I have all those same worries. And because that is certainly a hot spot, and there seems to be at least rhetorically more of a willingness to even think about using nuclear weapons, that concerns me greatly. I was sort of alarmed when I went on that trip saying, that's a doctrine, that's scary. So, you know, fortunately we haven't seen that. Hopefully we'll never see that, but it is a worry. Mm-hmm.
Well, thanks so much, Chris, again. And I'll concur with that comment about you're getting it, and hopefully we can continue to draw on your expertise and your experiences as we continue to grapple with this cyber issue in the nuclear context. So thanks again. Thanks again to everyone for tuning in. Thanks, Aaron, for handling those Q&A chores so well. And we'll say goodbye. But hope to see you again soon, Chris.
Thank you. And thanks to everyone who tuned in. It's been a great discussion. And we could probably spend several hours doing this. So
we could.
So thank you again.
Okay. Bye.